Hi, and welcome back to another episode of the Greatest Book Club in the World, the AK Book Club, yay! And today we have a special episode, extremely special episode, because today is episode number 108. 108, and it's going to be only one episode, only 108 episode. Like episode 108 is going to be filmed once, only once. Because yesterday was episode number 107, tomorrow is going to be number 109. And today it's episode number 108. Yeah. So guys, if you're new to the channel, welcome. And if you are already familiar with the channel, welcome back. My name is AK and I'm your host. And on this book club, we are working together on English speaking level and reading level and on communication skills for the camera. I'm doing so because I truly believe that English is the number one tool that each one of us must acquire in order to be successful in life. And the second tool that's going to help us a lot is to gain confidence to stand in front of the camera to communicate well through the camera, because we see that the whole world is shifting from personal to personal meeting, from TV consuming to your social media consuming. We are now consuming much more content on YouTube, on Facebook, on Instagram, on TikTok. And if you know, and which means that you don't need to be like a superstar and don't need the most expensive equipment. Or the most professional equipment to produce content. We just need a smartphone. Just need a smartphone that you can take a video with it, and you're ready to go. And if you are, even if you know how to communicate well through the camera, you can conquer the world, guys. And for my own studio, I got a web camera, I got a green screen, a mic. And that's it for now, guys, because, yeah, of course, I'm planning. You see, I didn't have planning, but my background is it's my room. You see, I'm shooting for the room, and I got a green screen, and it's my room, and yeah, that's what's up, guys. You don't need to have the most expensive studio and the most advanced studio to take a shot or to make a video. Just need your bedroom, green screen, and then you can do whatever you want. And you see, when I bought my equipment, yeah, I'm planning to buy a new equipment. I bought the camera and I got my cables from Alexa that I ordered. But I really like this camera, so I need to decide if I'm going to switch to the new camera. Because then you have a Canon 1200, and when I'm using my Canon, so it's make me like a black line over here, and it's make my screenshot smaller, and I don't like it. Maybe I'm going to buy a new camera, or I don't know. But anyway, I told myself that I won't buy anything unless I reach episode number 50. And if you test it, if you already at episode number 100, then I don't see that I'm going to stop this podcast any soon. So don't worry, guys. Don't worry. You're going to achieve episode number 1,000, at least 1,000. And I'm planning to achieve episode number 1 million. Yeah, we are going to achieve it. So stay tuned for it. Yeah, stay tuned for it. And that's it. So let's continue. And you see, to celebrate this great episode, special episode of episode number 108, I invite my friend Godzilla and Kong. Really nice movie, a lot of action. I don't know story, but a lot of action. And if you want to get this background, you can find it on, you know where. You can find it on Good Fun, yeah, and you got the link to it in the description below. And this grand background device is created by Kipish Fon. I don't know how to read his name. For now, you pronounce O with a double letter above him. On a 23rd on July 2019. It's almost 3 years ago. And of course, we leave a thumb up to this grand background. And if you're going to get If you want to get the full resolution of the background, just click on the picture, left click, right click, save as, and then you got it. And today we're continuing a journey with Ernest Becker, The Denial of Death. A really nice book. A lot of nice idea. I like this idea. And I already told you that I'm using the summary of the book to read it, because to understand what I'm reading, because this book is containing a lot of a new world for me, and I want to understand what I'm reading, so I'm using the summary of the book to read it, to understand what I'm reading. And now we are going to what I saw from now right now, that we are getting close to, let me adjust my chair, and now we are getting close to what I'm reading in the summary. So let's go. The Denial of Death by Ernest Becker. Page, where I close it. Wait a minute, we have a situation over here. Yeah, I close the book. I mean, I close it because I got a PDF of it. So now The Denial of Death, open it, reopen it. The Denial of Death by Ernest Becker, read by the myth, the legend, the man himself. Give me some run. The one and only, yo boy, AK, yeah, that's me. That's what's up, and let's go. Let's go. Today I'm going to challenge myself. I'm going to read from page 203 until page 220. Which is a lot of pages. It's the biggest amount of pages that I'm going to read in one shot. Let's see how I manage to do it. I do it because I want to change myself. Title: The Creative Solution. And I'm planning to finish the book in episode number 115, which means next week. Or next week you're going to get. The Binge Watch Party, you can get the award, The Denial of Death party. Title: The Creative Solution. The upshot of all this is that personal heroism, full individuation, is a very daring adventure precisely because it separates the person out of comfortable beyonds. Beyond. It takes the strength and the courage the average man doesn't have and couldn't even understand. The junk sober points out. The most terrifying burden of the creature is to be isolated, which is what happens in individuation. One separates himself out of the world, of the end. This move exposes the person with a sense of being completely crushed out of their own. This move exposes the person to the sense of being completely crushed and annihilated because he sticks out so much. Has to carry so much in himself. Less of the risks when the person begins to fashion consciously and critically his own framework of heroic self-reference. Here is precisely the definition of the artist type, or the creative type generally. We have crossed a threshold into a new type of a response to manage the situation. No one has written about this type of human response more penetrantly than Rank. And all of his books, Art and Artist is the most secure monument of his genius. I don't want to get into the kind of agonizingly subtle insights on the artist that Rank has produced, or to try to present his comprehensive picture. But it will reward us if we take this opportunity to get a bit deeper than we have into the problem of personality dynamics. It will prepare us for a discussion of Frank's views on neuroses. Richard Anne Pound in the psychoanalytic literature. So far as I know, the key to the creative type is that he is separated out of the common pool of shared meanings. There is something in his life experience that makes him take in the world as a problem. As a result, he has to make personal sense out of it. This holds true for all creative people to a greater or lesser extent. But it is especially obvious with the artist. Existence becomes a problem that needs an ideal power, an ideal answer. But when you no longer accept the collective solution to the problem of existence, then you must fashion your own. The work of art is, then, the ideal answer of the creative type to the problem of existence as it takes it in. Not only the existence of the external world, but especially his own. Who he is as a painfully separate person with nothing shared to lean on. He has to answer to the burden of his extreme individuation. He is so painful in isolation. He wants to know how to earn immortality as a result of his own unique gifts. His creative work is at the same time the expression of his heroism and the justification of it. It is his private religion, as Frank put it. His uniqueness gives him personal immortality. It is his own beyond and not that of others. No sooner have we said this than we can see the immense problem that it possesses. How can one justify his own heroism? He would have to be as God. Now we see even further how guilt is inevitable for men. Even as a creator, he is a creature overwhelmed by the creative process itself. If you stick out of nature so much that you yourself have to create your own heroic justification, it is too much. This is how we understand something that seems logical. That the more you develop a distinctive, free and critical human being, the more guilt you have. Your very work accuses you. It makes you feel inferior. What right do you have to play God? Especially if your work is great, absolutely new and different. You wonder where to get an alternative for introducing new meanings into the world, the strengths of to be it. It all boils down to this. The work of art is the artist's attempt to justify his heroism objectively in the concrete creation. It is a testimonial to his absolute uniqueness and the work transcendence. But the artist is still a creature and he can feel it more intensely than anyone else. In other words, he knows that the work is therefore bad, ephemeral, potentially meaningless, unless justified from outside himself and outside himself. In Jung's terms, that we noted previously, the work is the artist's own transference projection. And he knows that, consciously and critically. Whatever he does, he is stuck with himself, can't get securely outside and beyond himself. He's also stuck with the work of art itself. Like any material achievement, it is visible. Earthly, impermanent. No matter how great it is, it still fails in some ways next to the transcending majesty of nature. And so it is ambiguous, hardly a solid immortality symbol. In his greatest genius, man is still mocked. No wonder that historically art and the psychosis have had such an intimate relationship. the road to creativity to the road to creativity to creativity passes so close to the meadows, and often the tools and the ends or ends them. The artist and the madman are trapped by their own fabrications. The value is their own reality. In the protest, that they really are something special in creation. The whole thing boils down to this paradox. If you are going to be a hero, then you must give a gift. Then you must give a gift. If you are the average man, you give your heroic gift to the society. Again, the whole thing boils down to this paradox. If you're going to be a hero, then you must give a gift. If you are the average man, you give your heroic gift to the society in which you live, and you give the gift that society specializes in advance. If you are an artist, you fashion a peculiarly personal gift, the justification of your own heroic identity. Which means that it is always aimed at the last partly over the heads of your fellow men. After all, they can't grant the immortality of your personal soul. As Frank argued in the breathtaking closing chapter of Ardent Artist, there is no way for the artist to be at peace with his work or with the society that accepts it. The artist's gift is always to creation itself, to the ultimate meaning of life, to God. We should not be surprised that Rank was brought to exactly the same conclusion as Kierkegaard, that the only way out of human conflict is full renunciation, to give one's life as a gift to the highest powers. Absolution is to come from the absolute beyond. Rank showed that this rule applied to the strongest, most heroic types, not to trembling and empty weaklings. To renounce the world and oneself, to lie the meaning of it, the powers of creation, is the hardest thing for men to achieve. And so it is fitting that this task should fall to the strongest personality type, the one with the largest ego. The great scientific world shaker Newton was the same man who always carried the Bible under his arm. Even in such cases, the combination of fullest self-expression and renunciation is rare, as we saw in chapter 6 when we speculated about Freud's lifelong problem. From all that we have now covered, the self in history and in personal creativity, we can perhaps draw even closer to the problem of Freud. We know that he was a genius, and we can now see the real problem the genius has: how to develop a creative work with the full force of one's passion, a work that saves one's soul, and at the same time to renounce that very work, because it cannot be itself, because it cannot by itself give salvation. In the creative genius, we see the need to combine the most intensive arrows of self-expression with the most complete gap of self-surrender. It is almost too much to ask of men that they contrive to experience fully both those intensities of ontological striving. Perhaps men with lesser gifts have it easier. A small dose of heroes and a comfortable agape. Freud lived the daemon of his heroes to the hilt, and more honestly than most. And it consumed him and others around him, as it always does, more or less. Psychoanalysis was his personal heroic bid for immortality. As Frank said, he himself who is so easily convinced is antagonistic and antagonistic angosticism, while he had created for himself a private religion. But this was precisely for his being. As an angostic, he had no one to offer his gift to. No one, that is, who had any more security of immortality, than he did himself. Not even mankind itself was secure. As he confessed, the specter of the dinosaurs still hunts men and will always hunt him. For it was anti-religious because if someone could not personally give the gift of his life to a religious ideal, he saw such a step as weakness, a passivity that would defeat his own creative urge for more life. Then he joins the gay ground in the belief that one should not stop the circumscribe his life with beyond that earning it end, or a bit further out, or keep it unkept or created by oneself. One should reach for the highest beyond of religion. Men should cultivate the passivity of renunciation to the highest powers, no matter how difficult it is. Anything less is less than full development, even if it seems like a weakness and compromise to the best thinkers. Nietzsche relied that the Judeo-Christian renunciatory morality, but as Frank said, he overlooked the deep need in the human being for just that kind of morality. Rank goes so far as to say that the need for a truly religious ideology is innate in human nature, and its fulfillment is basic to any kind of social life. The Freud and others imagine that surrender to God is a masochistic, that to empty oneself is demanding. Well, answers Rank. It represents, on the contrary, the fullest reach of the self, the highest idealization a man can achieve. It represents the fulfillment of the Egypt love expansion, the achievement of the truly creative type. Only in this way, says Rank, only by surrendering to the biggest of nature on the highest, least fetishes level, can men conquer death. In other words, the true heroic validation of one's life lies beyond sex, beyond the other, beyond the private religion. All this are makeshifts that pull men down, or that aim him in. Leaving him torn with ambiguity. Men feel the inferior precisely when he lacks true inner values in the personality, when he is merely a reflex of something next to him and has to no studying inner gyroscope, no centering in himself. And in order to get such a centering, men has to look beyond the door, beyond the consolations of others and of the things of this world. Man is a theological being, concludes Rank, and not a biological one. In all this, it is a stoic. While speaking and behind him, Kierkegaard and Augustine. But what makes it uncanny in the present world of science is that those are the conclusions of the life work of a psychoanalyst, not a theologian. The net effect of it is overwhelming. And to someone trained early in a field of science, the whole thing seems confused. Such a mixture of intensive clinical insight and the pure Christian ideology is absolutely easy. One doesn't know what kind of emotional attitude to assume towards it. It seems to pull one in several irreconcilable directions at the same time. At this point, the thought-minded scientist, as he likes to call himself, slams shut the covers of the book by rank and turns away with a shudder. What a shame that Freud's closest collaborator should turn so soft in the head, should deliver over to the easy consolations of religion and a downborn knowledge of psychoanalysis. So he would think and he would be wrong. Rank made a complete closure of psychoanalysis on Kierkegaard, but he did not do it out of weakness or wishfulness. He did it out of the logic of the historical psychoanalytic understanding of man. There is simply no way for the critic of Rank to get around this. If he thinks Rank is not hard-headed or empirical enough, it is because he has not really come to grips with the art of Frank's world work, his elaboration of the nature of neurosis. This is Rank's answer to those who imagine that he stopped short in his scientific quest or went soft out of personal motives. Rank's understanding of the neurotic is a key to his world thought. It is of vital importance for a full post-Freudian understanding of man and at the same time represents the locus of the intimate merger of Frank's thought with Kierkegaard's on terms and in language that Kierkegaard himself would have found comfortable. Let us explore it in more detail in the next chapter. New chapter, guys, new chapter, yeah, let's go. Chapter 9, the present outcome of psychoanalysis. Page 209. If man is a more normal, healthy and happy, the more he can successfully repress, displace, deny, rationalize, dramatize himself, and deceive others. Then it follows that the suffering of the neurotic comes from painful truth. Spiritually, the neurotic has been long since things were. Psychoanalysis wants to bring him before being able to, namely at the point of seeing through the deception of the world of sense, the falsity of reality. He suffers not from all the pathological mechanisms which are psychically necessary for living in the wholesome, but in the refusal of those mechanisms, which is just what robs him of the illusion important for living. He is much nearer to the actual truth psychologically than the others, and it is just that from which he suffers. Otto Rank. Rank wrote about neurosis all through his work. A line or a paragraph here, a page or two there. And he gave many different and even contradictory definitions of it. Sometimes he made it seem normal and universal. At other times, he saw it as unhealthy and private. Sometimes he used the term of for smaller problems of living. It others used it to include the actual psychosis. This elasticity of feelings is not due to confused thinking. The fact is, as we shall shortly see, that neurosis sums up all the problems of human life. Matran could have helped his own work enormously by putting a conceptual order into his insights on mental illness. If a thinker falls off too many unsystematic and rich insights, there is no place to grab onto his thought. The thing is trying to illuminate. The thing is trying to illuminate. Seems as elusive as before. It is certain that Freud's prominence is due to no small extent to his ability to make clear, simple, and systematic all of his insights, and always to reduce the most complex theory to a few fundamentals. You can do this with rank two, but the rub is that you must do it yourself by putting your own order into the broadside of rank's work. Alpha rank knew that this requirement wasn't to the reader or to himself. He never did find anyone to write his books. And so we ourselves have to try to go beyond the confusion of insights and penetrate to the heart of the problem. As a point of departure, let us first sum up everything that nuances covers and then take up one thing at a time to show how they all fit together. Neurosis as free in the interdependent aspects. In the first place, it refers to people who are having trouble living with the truth of existence. It is universal in this sense because everybody has some trouble living with the truth of life and pays some vital ransom to the truth. In the second place, neurosis is private because each person fashions his own peculiar stylistic reaction to life. Finally, beyond both of those, is perhaps the unique gift of Frank's work, that neurosis is also historical and to a large extent. Because all the traditional ideologies that is squeezed and absorbed it have fallen away and modern ideologies are just too thin to contain it. So we have a modern man. Increasingly slumping onto analysts, coaches, making pilgrimages to psychological guru centers, and joining therapy groups, and filling larger and larger numbers of mental hospital beds. Let us look at each of those three aspects in more detail. The neurotic type. First, as a problem of personal character. When we say neurosis represents the true of life, we again mean that life is an overwhelming problem for an animal free of instinct. The individual has to protect himself against the world, and he can do this only as any other animal would, by narrowing down the world, shutting off experience, developing an obliviousness both the terrors of the world and to his own anxieties. Otherwise, he would be crippled for action. We cannot repeat too often the great lesson of Freudian psychology, that representation is a normal self-protection and creative self-restriction. In a real sense, Man is a natural substitute for instinct. Rank as a perfect key term for this natural human talent. He calls it partialization, and very rightly sees that life is impossible without it. What we call the justest man is just this capacity to partialize the world for comfortable action. I've used the term fetishization, which is exactly the same idea. The normal man bites off what he can chew and digs of life, and no more. In other words, men aren't built to be gods, to take in the whole world. They are built like other creatures, taking the piece of ground in front of their noses. God can take in the world in the world of creation because they alone can make sense of it, know what it is all about for. But as soon as a man lifts his nose from the ground and starts sniffing at eternal problems like life and death, the meaning of a rose or a star cluster, then he is in trouble. Most men spare themselves this problem by keeping their minds on the small problems of their lives, just as their society maps those problems out for them. Those are what Kierkegaard calls the immediate man and the Philistines. They tranquilize themselves with the trivial, and so they can lead a normal life. It sounds bad to tell you, it sounds limited. But it's making you think about what the meaning of life and what just make you think. Right away, we can see the immensely fertile horizon that opens up in all of our thinking on a mental health and normal behavior. In order to function normally, man has to achieve from the beginning in a serious constriction of the world and end of himself. We can say that the essence of normality is a refusal of reality. Magical neuroses enters precisely at this point. Some people have more trouble with their lies than others. The world is too much with them, and the techniques that they have developed for holding it at bay day and cutting and holding it, they've developed for holding it at bay and cutting it down to size finally begin to choke the person himself. This is a neurosis in a nutshell. The miscarriage of clumsy lies about reality. But we can also see it at once that there is no line between normal and neurotic, as we all lie and are all bound in some ways by the lies. Neurosis is then something we all share. It is universal, or putting it another way, normality is neurosis and vice versa. We call a man neurotic when his lie begins to show the damaging effects on him or on people around him, and he seeks clinical help for it, or rather seek it for him. Otherwise, we call the refusal of reality normal because it doesn't occasion any visible problems. It is really as simple as that. After all, if someone who lives alone wants to get out of bed a half a dozen times to see if the door is really locked, or another washes and dries his hands exactly three times every time, uses a handful of toilet tissue each time to relieve himself, there is really no human problem involved. Those people are ruining their safety in the face of the reality of creatureliness. In relatively in cautious and troublesome ways. But the whole thing becomes more complex when we see how the lies about reality begin to miscarry. Then we have to begin to apply the label in neurotic. And there are any number of occasions there for this, from many ranges of human experience. Generally speaking, we call neurotic any lifestyle that begins to constrict too much, that prevents a free forward momentum, new choices and growth that a person might want and need. For example, a person who is trying to find his salvation only in a love relationship, but who is being defeated by this too narrow focus is neurotic. He can become overly passive and dependent, fearful of venturing out of his zone, of making his love without his partner. No matter how that partner treats him, the object has become his all, his world, and is reduced to the status of a simple reflex of another human being. This type frequently looks for clinical help. He feels stuck in his narrow horizon, needs this particular and beyond, but feels moving past it. In terms we used earlier, we could say that his self-heroics is not working out. It is choking him, poisoning him with the damped realization that it is so safe that it is not heroic at all. To lie to oneself about one's own potential development is another cause of guilt. It is one of the most insidious daily inner governings of person can, of governings. It is one of the most insidious daily inner governings a person can experience. Guilt, remember, is a bind that man experiences when he is humbled and stopped in ways that he does not understand. When he is overshadowed in his energies by the world, but the misfortune of man is that he can experience this guilt in two ways: as a battlement from without and from within, by being stopped in relation to his own potential development. Guilt results from unused life, from the unlived in us. More sensational are those other familiar miscarriages of lies about reality, what we call obsessions and compulsions, phobias of all kinds. Here we see the results of too much fetishization or partialization, too much narrowing down of the world for action. The result is that the person gets stuck in the narrowness. It is one thing to ritually wash once and ends three times. It's another to wash them until the ends bleed and one is in the bathroom most of the day. Here we see in pure culture, as it were, what is at stake in all human representation: the fear of life and death, safety in the face of the real terror of creature existence, is becoming a real problem for the person. He feels vulnerable, which is the truth, but he reacts too totally. To inflexibility. He fears going out in the street, or up in elevators, or into transportation of any kind. At this extreme, it is as though the person says to himself, If I do anything at all, I will die. We can see that the symptoms is an attempt to live, an attempt to unblock action and keep the world safe. The fear of life and death is encapsulated in the symptom. If you feel vulnerable, it is because you feel bad and inferior, not big or strong enough to face up to the terrors of the universe. You walk out your need for perfection, bigness, invulnerability in the symptoms. Say, end bashing or the avoidance of sex in marriage. We might say that the symptoms itself represents the locus of the performance of heroism. No wonder that one cannot give it up. That would release all by itself the whole flood of terror that one is trying to deny and overcome. When you put all your eggs in one basket, you must clutch that basket for dear life. It is a stone one will to take the whole world and fuse it into a single object or a single film. We immediately recognize this as the same creative dynamic and that the person uses in transference. When he fuses all the terror and majesty of creation in the transference object. This is what Rank meant when he said that neurosis represents creative problem gone astray and confused. The person doesn't really know what the problem is, but he eats on an ingenious way to keep moving past it. Let us note, too, that Freud himself uses the expression transference and neurosis as a collective term for hysterical things and compulsion neurosis. We can say that Rank and the modern psychiatry merely simplify and carry through this basic insight. But now putting the burden of explanation on life and death fears, not merely on DPL dynamics. One young psychiatrist has recently summed up the whole matter beautifully in the following words. Must be clear that the despair and the anguish of which the patient complains is not the result of such symptoms, but rather are the reasons for their existence. It's in fact those very symptoms that shield him from the torment of the profound contradictions that lie at the heart of human existence. The particular phobia or obsession is a very means by which man, he says, the burden of his life's task is able to suggest his sense of insignificance. Thus, neurotic symptoms serve to reduce the narrow, to magically transform the world so that he might be distracted from his concerns of death, guilt, and meaninglessness. The neurotic preoccupied with his symptoms, is led to believe that his central task is one of confrontation with his particular obsession or phobia. In a sense, his neurosis allows him to take control of his destiny, to transform the world of life's meaning into the simplified meaning emanating from his self-created world. The ironic thing about the narrowing down of neurosis is that the person seeks to avoid death, but he does it by killing off so much of himself and so large a spectrum of his action world that he is actually isolating and diminishing himself and becomes a stone dead. There is just no way for the living creature to avoid life and death. And it is probably poetic justice that if he tries too hard to do so, he destroys himself. But we still haven't exhausted the range of behaviors that we can call neurotic. Another way of approaching neurosis is from the opposite end of the problem. There is a type of person who has a difficulty fetishizing and narrowing down. He has a vivid imagination, takes in too much experience, too large a chunk of the world, and this too much be called neurotic. We introduced this type in the last chapter where we talked about the creative person. We saw that these people feel their isolation, their individuality. They stick out, are less built into normal society, less securely programmed for automatic cultural election. To have difficulty partializing experience is to have difficulty living. Not to be able to fetishize makes one susceptible to the world as a total problem. Before the living again, that this exposure raises. We say that partializing the world is beating off what an animal can chew. Not to have this talent means constantly beating off more than one can chew. Rank puts it this way. The neurotic type makes the reality surrounding him a part of his ego, which explains his painful in relation to it. For all outside processes, however, however unmeaningful they might be in themselves, finally concern him. He is bound up in a kind of a magic unity with the volatility of life around him, much more than the adjusted type who can be satisfied with the role of a part, within the whole. The neurotic type is taking into himself potentially the whole of reality. Now we can see how the problem of neurosis can be laid out along the lines of the twin ontological motifs. On the one end, one emerges with the world around him and becomes too much a part of it, and so loses his own claim to life. On the other end, one cuts oneself off. Of the world in order to make one's own complete claim, and so loses the ability to live and act in the world on its terms. As Frank put it, some individuals are unable to separate and others are unable to unite. The idea, of course, is to find some balance between the two motives, such as characterized the better adjusted person, is at ease with both. The neurotic represents precisely an extreme at one end or the other. It feels that one or the other is a burden. The question for Karak theology is why some people cannot balance their ontological urges. Why they yag in the extremes? The answer must obviously go back to the personal life history. There are those who shrink back from experience out of greater life and death anxieties. They grow up not giving themselves freely to the cultural roles available to them. They can't lose themselves totally. Totally in the games is the thousands play. One reason is that they have trouble relating to others. They haven't been able to develop the necessary interpersonal skills. Playing the game of society with automatic is a means playing with others without an anxiety. If you are not involved in what others take for granted as a new enrichment of their lives, then your own life becomes a total problem. At its extreme, this describes the scriosis type R excellence. Classically, this state was called the narcissistic neurosis or psychosis. The psychotic is the one who cannot shut out the world. Both representations are all on the surface, whose defenses no longer work. And so he withdraws from the world and into himself and his fantasies. He fences himself off and becomes his own world, narcissism. It might seem courageous to take in the whole world. Instead of just beating off pieces and acting on them, but as Sonic points out, this is also precisely a defense against engagement in it. This apparent egocentricity originally just a defense mechanism against the danger of reality. The neurotic seeks to complete his ego constantly without paying for it. To live is to engage in experience at least partly of the terms, at least partly of the terms of the experience itself. One has to stick his neck out in the action without any guarantees about the satisfaction or safety. One never knows how it will come out, or how silly we look. But the neurotic type wants those guarantees. He doesn't want to risk his self-image. Ren calls this very aptly the self-wild over-revelation of self. Whereby the neurotic tries to cheat nature, he won't pay the price that nature wants of him, to age, to fall ill, or be injured, and die. Instead of living experience, he ideates it. Instead of arranging it in action, he works it all out in his head. We can see that neurosis is par excellence the danger of a symbolic animal whose body is a problem to him. Instead of living biologically, then he lives symbolically. Instead of living in the pathway that nature provided for, he lives in the total way made possibly by symbols. One substitutes the magical, all-inclusive world of the self for the real. Fragmentary world of experience. Again, in this sense, everyone is neurotic, and someone holds back from life in some ways and lets its symbolic worldview arrange things. This is what cultural morality is for. In this sense, too, the artist is the most neurotic, because he too takes the world as totally and makes a largely symbolic problem out of it. If this neurosis characterizes everyone to a certain extent, and the artist most of all, where do we cross the line into neurosis as a clinical problem? One way, as we saw, is by the production of crippling symptoms or a too constricting lifestyle. The person has tried to cheat nature by restricting his experience, but he remains sensitive the term of life. At some level of his awareness. Besides, he can't arrange his triumph over life and death in his mind or in his narrow heroics without paying some price. The symptoms of a bogging down in guilt and the futility because of an unlived life. A second way of crossing the line into clinical neurosis follows naturally from everything we have said. Rank asks why the artist so often avoids clinical neurosis when he is so much candidated for it, because of his vivid imagination. His openness to the finest and broadest aspect of experience. Is a solution from the cultural world view that satisfies everyone else. The answer is that it takes in the world, but instead of being oppressed by it, he revokes it in his own personality and recreates it in the work of art. The neurotic is precisely the one who cannot create. The artist Menuki, as Frank so adeptly called him. We might say that both the artist and the neurotic bite off more than they can chew. But the artist spews it back out again and chews it over in an objectified way as an external active work project. The neurotic can't marshal this creative response embodied in a specific work. And so it chokes on his introversions. That is a similar large scale introversions, but he uses them as material. In Alex inspired the conceptualization, the difference is put like this. It is this very fact of the ideologization of purely physical conflicts that makes the difference between the productive and the unproductive types, the artist and the neurotic. For the neurotic's creative problem, like the most primitive artist, is always tied to his own self and exhausts itself in it. Whereas the productive type succeeds in changing this purely subjective creative process into an objective one, which means that for ideology, he transfers it from his own self to his work. The neurotic exhausts himself not only in self preoccupations like idiotic feelings and all sorts of fantasies, but also in others. Those around him on whom he is dependent, they become his therapeutic work project. He takes out his subjective problems on them, but people are not clay to be molded. They have needs and encounter wills of their own. The neurotic's frustration as a field artist can be reminded by anything but an objective creative work of his own. Another way of looking at it is to say that the more totally one takes in the world as a problem, the more inferior or bad one is going to feel inside oneself. He can try to work out this badness by striving for perfection. And then the neurotic symptoms becomes his creative work, comes his creative work. Or he can try to make himself perfect by means of his partner. But it is obvious to us that the only way to work on perfection is in the form of an objective work that is fully under our control, that is fully under your control and is perfectible in some real ways. Either you eat up yourself and others around you, trying for perfection, or you objectively that imperfection in a work, on which you then unleash your creative powers. In this sense, some kind of objective creativity is the only answer man has to the problem of life. In this way, he satisfies nature. In this way, he satisfies nature, which asks that he live and act objectively as a vital animal plunging into the world. But he also satisfies his own distinctive human nature because he plunges in on his own symbolic terms and not as a reflex of the world as given to a mere physical sense experience. He takes in the world, makes a total problem out of it, and then gives out a passionate human answer to the problem. This is so enforced, is the highest that man can achieve. From this point of view, the difference between the artist and the neurotic seems to boil down largely to a question of talent. It is like the difference between an illiterate schizophrenic and a stringberg. One ends up on the backforce and the other becomes a cultural hero. But both experience the world in similar ways, and only the quality and the power of the reaction differ. If the neurotic feels vulnerable in the face of the world he takes in, he reacts by criticizing himself to excess. He can't endure himself for the isolation that his individuality plunges him into. On the other hand, he still needs to be a hero, still needs to earn immortality on the basis of his unique qualities, which means that he still must glorify himself in some ways. But he can glorify himself only in fantasy, as he cannot fashion a creative work that speaks on his behalf by virtue of its objective perfection. He is caught in a vicious circle because he experiences the unreality of fantasized self-glorification. There is really no conviction possible for man unless it comes from others or from outside himself in some way, at least not for long. Once if he cannot justify his own heroism in his own inner symbolic fantasy, which is what leads the neurotic to feel more unworthy and inferior. This is pretty much the situation. Of the adolescent who has not discovered his inner gifts. The artist, on the other hand, overcomes his inferiority and glorifies himself because he has the talent to do so. From all this, we can see how interchangeably, we can talk about neuroses. Adolescence, normality is the artist, with only varying degrees of difference, or with a fissural additive like talent making all the difference. Talent itself is usually largely circumstantial. the result of Flack and Wonk, which makes Rank's view of neurosis true to life. Artists are neurotic as well as creative. The greatest of them can have crippling neurotic symptoms and can cripple those around them, as well by their as well as their neurotic demands and needs. Look what Carlyle did to his wife. There is no doubt that creative work is itself done under a compulsion, often indistinguishable from a purely clinical obsession. In this sense, what we call a creative gift is merely the social license to be obsessed. And what we call a cultural routine is a similar license, a proletariat demands the obsession of work in order to keep from going crazy. I used wonder how people could stand the reality, demonic activity of working behind those hellish ranges in hotel kitchens. The fronting free vril or waiting on a dozen tables at one time. The madness of the travel agents office at the height of the tourist season. Or the torture of working with a jackhammer all day on a hot summer street. The answer is so simple that is allows us, ELUDES, us. The craziness of those activities is exactly that of the human condition. They are right for us because the alternative is natural depression. The daily madness of those jobs is a repeated vaccination against the madness of the asylum. Look at the joy and the eagerness with which workers return from the vacation to their compulsive routines. They plunge into their work with equanimity and lightheartedness. Because it drowns out something more ominous, men have to be protected from reality, all of which possess another gigantic problem to a sophisticated Marxism. Namely, what is the nature of the obsessive denials of reality that a utopian society will provide to keep men from going mad? Why, damn, guys, this was episode today and it was long. But this is what needed to be done in order for us to finish the book on next Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, for the next full day, next on the next week. And let's see if you are going to make it. Of course, we are going to make it because we are the greatest book club in the world. And when we say we are going to do something, we are going to do it. So guys, thank you very much for joining me for this special episode, the longest episode until now. Now, I hope you enjoy it. Now I'm going to take my dogs for a walk. I need to clean up my head, don't force myself. But I have to tell you that the last episodes contained so much deep thoughts, deep ideas they need to process, and yeah, it's Great book. I love the ideas. And the niche ideas that Ernest Becker present, I think we can devour and we can dig for a whole book on niche idea, on why we are thinking this way and why we are want to do this, why we are one as a human being to do this and this and this. But, you know, it is what it is. Guys, thank you very much for joining me. I really hope that you enjoyed this episode. I really appreciate the fact that you choose and invest your time with me. So guys, stay safe and stay at home until the coronavirus is behind us. And go out there, have a great time with your friends, family, and neighbors. I know there are not places around the world. They are opening the gates and you can go whenever you want. But be safe and don't take unnecessary risks, because you need to inspire the world, guys, and you need to share the world your wisdom and your motivation and your message, because you're special and there's only one of you in the world, and the way that you see the world is unique to you, and if you're not going to share it, nobody's going to share your way. Yeah, you might think similar to other people, to other human beings, to other societies, to other communities, but each one of us is unique. And being to understand it. And I think this book is talk about it also. So guys, just enjoy your life, spread your message, continue to watch and support, and invest time with our greatest book club in the world, like a book club. And I hope to see you all tomorrow, guys, for the next episode of a very special episode of the greatest book club in the world, like a book club. Until then, have a great time. Take care of yourself and bye-bye. Peace. AK is the king.